almost any time. And a crown of life that's waiting, thank God will soon be mine. I got my invitation from a place called Calvary. By the precious blood of Jesus, my trip's been paid for me.
I'm going home to Jesus in the twinkling of an eye. I made my reservation for a mansion in the sky.
Is calling, get on board,
yeah.
And the destination's heaven, safe on the crystal shore, where we will meet our Savior and our loved ones who have gone to live eternally. Oh yes, I'm going home.
Going home with Jesus in the twinkling of an eye. I've made my reservation for a mansion in the sky.
Take your Bibles, please. Turn over to Mark chapter 8. Mark chapter 8 and verse 1. We've been journeying through a little bit of Mark, and we've been going through that, trying to verse by verse, to just see, again, what it's like to run around with Jesus. Mark gives us some great insight on what it's like to run around with Jesus, to go on journey with Jesus, whether it's in the Jewish areas or the Gentile areas. He gives us some great insight on what that's like. And the disciples learned a lot by hanging out with Jesus. And so we would be wise to take the scriptures and see what the Bible tells us and learn about how to live walking with Christ. Mark chapter 8 and verse 1. We pick it up and it says this. In those days, the multitude being very great and having nothing to eat, Jesus called his disciples to him and said to them, I have compassion on the multitude because they have now continued with me 3 days and have nothing to eat. If I send them away hungry to their own houses, they will faint on the way, for some of them have come from afar. Then the Bible says in verse 4, then his disciples answered him. This is interesting. They said this, how can one satisfy these people with bread here in the wilderness? And he asked them, how many loaves do you have? They said, seven. Verse 6 says, so he commanded the multitude to sit down on the ground, and he took the seven loaves and gave thanks, broke them, and gave them to his disciples to set before them, and they set them before the multitude. They also had a few small fish, and having blessed them, he set them also before them. So they ate and were filled, and they took up seven large baskets of leftover fragments. Now those who had eaten were about 4,000. And he sent them away. And verse 10 says, immediately he got to the boat and his disciples, and came to the region of Dalmatia. And that's a great passage of Scripture, because we come to Mark chapter 8, and when we do, we realize this is the second largest meal that's recorded in the Bible. The second largest meal. The first one was in Mark chapter 6, when he fed, what? 5,000 plus women and children. Some estimate at that point 20, 25,000 people probably. So that was the first big meal that Jesus was a part of in that setting. And he healed and did again great and wonderful things, but he fed those people miraculously. Now this is the second feeding. And this feeding is a little bit different. It's the second. And out of all the miracles that Jesus did, all the signs and wonders that he did, and all the, again, the great and wonderful things, and really particularly this second meal that's mentioned, I think this is one of the things that is less looked at, most neglected story of Jesus' miracles that you find in the Bible. And the reason is many people overlook it because some people say, well, that's just a recount of the story in Mark 6 where Jesus fed over 5,000 people, and Mark's just sort of going through it again, and there's a lot of similarities there, so people sort of discard it. And I can tell you, even from preaching sometimes, you may look at it and go, well, I just preached on the 5,000. Why would you want to go in now and just a few days later preach on the 4,000? And again, it's easy to neglect that when you're going through the Scriptures. But one of the things we realize is this. This is a powerful passage of Scripture. Often neglected, but not needed to be, because it's very important in the life of what we see going on in the life of Jesus and the disciples and the surrounding area. Some people, again, believe it's the same group, it's the same picture, but it is not. A lot of similarities, but totally different. The crowd in the first, the feeding of the 5,000, was only with Jesus one day. What we read here is the feeding of the 4,000, they were with him for 3 days. The first crowd and the feeding of the 5,000, Mark says, was seated on the green grass. Now this in setting is they are seated on the ground. You say, what's the difference? Because the green grass in Galilee was a time of the springtime. Now it's been several months later. Now they are in the late summertime. And now they're sitting on the ground. Implication there is the summertime. The first group, he fed the 5 loaves and 2 fish. That's an interesting passage, because we see the word used there for fish is regular fish. When we were in that area, basically what we did was we got something to eat. And I said, I want some fish from the Sea of Galilee. And so I should have gave you a picture of it. It's you say, you ate that? I said, yeah, it is. I mean, it's a nice fish, but they left the head and the eyes in there. I'm thinking, well, what? You say you don't eat green beans, but you eat that? Yeah, I did. I didn't eat that part of it now. I just ate the good part. But it's a regular fish. I mean, it was just a different size fish there. But that's the term, that's the word used there in the Bible. In this second account, the 4,000, it's a term that uses for a few fish. The Bible says a few small fish. And what we would compare that to would be a sardine type of fish. So the first account was a nice bigger fish. This account would be the smaller sardine type of fish. The first account, we see the disciples in the 5,000, Jesus tells them to pick up the loaves and the leftovers, basically 12 basketful. And then also in the second account, we see him pick up how many? Seven large baskets. You see, is there a difference? Absolutely, there's a difference. The word large baskets there is spuris that he uses in the Greek. It means this, it means a hamper of sorts. So it was a big, it wasn't just a little small basket, it was a big basket. And it's the same word used in Acts chapter 9, verse 25 and following out there, where they lowered Paul down to escape from the Jews. Remember, the Jews were trying to kill him, and they had to get him out of town, so they lowered him in a basket. That's the same basket. So seven big old basketfuls is in the second one. Small little spurious, though, that's a little term used for small baskets. It's a basket they would use many times to pass out communion. So you see the difference, right? Small large. Just some different comparisons. And then finally, we see here again, this is two different locations. In chapter 6, we see Galilee is where it took place, the Jewish territory, occupied territory. And now in Mark chapter 8, we find that Jesus now is doing this great miracle, but he's doing it in Gentile country. Okay, this is the Gentile occupied area. So it's Decapolis. We talked about that. Deca meaning 10, polis meaning city. So it's an area of 10 cities. So it's totally different. In fact, if you want a little bit more of that to help you do a little study, Matthew chapter 8, verse 17, Jesus basically says they're two different stories. I'm amazed sometimes at people who study the Bible and they look and they go, well, I think this, you know, just read on, keep reading. And Jesus starts talking to them about, they start talking to him about bread, and they look at him and they say some different things about it. Jesus said, don't you remember when I just fed those, how many baskets? And he tells us that these are two different stories. I believe the key to this story, though, is found in its location. I think one of the things that we need to remember that the Lord Jesus Christ, and really what it's interesting, because a lot of times I don't take as much time to really emphasize the location of things, but in this study of Mark, it's very important as they journey with Jesus all over the country, it's important that we understand where he's at, because where he's at is important to understand why he's there. He's not just there to show up and just sort of go, hey, how did I end up here? We're just going to go for a trip. We're just going to ride around and see where we go. No, he's got a purpose. And that's very important when we start looking at the location. Because Jesus had left the Jewish country for several months. Now he's in the Galilean area, as we said. And this is the last recorded event that we have in the life of Jesus and the disciples where they go into Galilean or the Gentile area. So Jesus, again, he's been traveling all up, and we looked at the map last week, traveling all up and around, over 150-mile round-trip journey, and he's been doing that. Now he's in Gentile area, covering that ground, and this is the last event that we see Jesus before he goes to the cross and dies for the sins of mankind. It's the last time we see him in Gentile country. I think that's important. I think that's very important when we see what he's done with the disciples through this whole process. The disciples, again, they're learning. They're learning. And that's why I look at this sometimes and I go, Lord, I'm just going to pretend like I'm a disciple. Show me what they saw. Help me understand what they learned. Because in understanding what they learned and seeing what they saw, I can grow in my walk with you. And so we see this, several things here. We see the disciples learned in this journey with Jesus. Number one, they learned this, that God cares about Gentiles. You say, well, that's not a big deal. Oh, it's a huge deal. These boys were not trained that way. They understood Gentiles to be dogs. They understood Gentiles to be filth. Listen, when they came back from the head to travel through Gentile area, they would walk back into their country and shake the dust off their feet because they did not want to get Gentile dirt or sand to contaminate their own land. And that's why when you read in the Bible and you see this conflict all the time with the way Jews are treating Gentiles, it was terrible. But that's the way they were brought up. That's the way they were taught. I've had people tell me before in certain situations, we start saying something, they'll say some kind of racial statement. I go, whoa, hold up. You can't say that. Oh, that's just the way I was brought up. I just brought up that way. And I look at them and go, you brought up wrong. They were brought up wrong in that context to think that the Gentiles were dirt. And so Jesus takes them on a journey to help them understand that God loves Gentiles too, not just the Jews. Disciples also learned as well in their training that one day they needed to understand that because one day they would be sent out to Samaria, watch this, and the uttermost parts of the earth. They needed to understand how God loved the world. You can't go into an area thinking you're better than somebody else, thinking you're up here and they're down here, and you're going to share with them the gospel of Jesus. So Jesus knew that, of course, and he's taking them on this journey to teach them, again, how much God loves the world. Also taught them, most thirdly, about how God cares for everyone and the world. And this vivid teaching, again, was to open their eyes to that fact, as we said, to understand that each individual person, watch this, women and children and men alike. It's no coincidence that Jesus deals with women and children a lot in his ministry. You know why? Because women and children were not looked at very valuable in those days. They were sort of cast aside and sort of belittled. The men were here. the women were here and the children were here. But it is no coincidence that Jesus deals with them, each and every one, not only men and women and children, or women and children, but also Gentile women, Gentile children. Very important picture. Also, even again, a more opportunity for Jesus and to show his disciples and the Gentiles that he is, listen carefully, the one true God. That he is God. When they would, listen, they would look, he'd calm the sea, right? And they'd look and they'd go, whoa, 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 what manner of man is this? Who is this guy? You think, well, they run with him all the time. Certainly they know he's God. They struggle with that. They struggle with it. And they had to learn. They had to be taught. Watch, they had to see the power of God in Jesus. And people, listen, they would see the miracles of Jesus, and they would get on him and say, well, you're doing miracles, the Pharisees, you're doing miracles by the devil. I mean, you remember the whole scenario, Jesus would just be just wrung out over all these different things. His disciples needed to understand, and the people around him needed to understand that he and he alone is God. It's a great opportunity to show his power, to show who he was to the people. But it was also something, in looking at this passage of Scripture, looking at the journey, to see how he was displaying and he was showing his love and his compassion. Being God, walking in human flesh, see, there was a whole lot, not only was there distortion thinking about the Gentiles, there was a lot of distorted thinking about who God was and how he acted and his attributes and his character and all those things. They had the psalm, they had all those different Old Testament, but they never really got it. They never understood. Now Jesus is walking on the earth and they're looking at him going, wow, who is this guy? He speaks and look what happens. He doesn't talk like the Pharisees. People getting healed. He's just touching. He's talking. I mean, it's amazing to see the power of God. But one of the things they noticed in the midst of his power, we're going to see in a moment, is his love and his mercy and his compassion. God is a God of compassion. God is a God of mercy. He's a God of healing. And he's a God of the whole world. Folks, it would be good for us in this modern day that we live to never lose sight of the fact of who Jesus is. I believe the song. I believe this. I believe this. I believe this. I believe this. But do we? I can say I believe anything, but is it shown in the way I live? The disciples could say anything, but then through their life, Jesus would say many times, where's your faith, guys? Where's your faith? I mean, in this story, how are we going to feed these people? Nothing around here, you know, Walmart's closed. Jesus is like, did you forget? You need bread? Bread of life right here. I mean, they forgot over and over. We're going to see that again in a moment, but so do we. We forget. Some of the great truths in this passage of Scripture, and I'm going to try to get these to you quick. Well, the first one's going to be a little longer, but I'll try to get these to you. We'll see how far we get. Number one, I want you to see this morning. I want you to see the compassion of our Lord. Well, one of the things that I don't hear a lot about today is the compassion of God. People like talking about the wrath of God, and God has wrath, I'm telling you. And the great thing about his love and compassion is because he has wrath, he stands up over and he's against wickedness and sin and unholiness and unrighteousness, right? That's why he shows his love, because there is that side. But the compassion of our Lord, look what he says here in verse 2, powerful statement. This is going to be interesting, watch this. Jesus said, I have compassion on the multitude. Stop there. Did you know that this is the only time here in Matthew, with Matthew 15, when he records this story, Matthew does the same story, the same event. Do you realize that's the only time in the Bible that you hear Jesus say, I have compassion? Nowhere else in the Bible. The only place you see Jesus say, I have compassion. That's interesting. You say, well, I'm not sure about that, preacher. Well, look it up later. We have a lot in the Bible, and I could take it all your day to tell you stories and show you in the Bible, and the stories in the Bible to say that other people, third person people say, he had compassion. Jesus had compassion. He had compassion on this person. He had compassion on that person. He reached out and because of his compassion, over and over and over again, people would say, by Jesus' life, they would say, he had compassion. But only here do you see him say himself, I have compassion. In Matthew 20, verse 32, just one story, or a couple instances here. So Jesus stood still and called them and said, what do you want me to do for you? They said to him, Lord, that our eyes may be open. The two blind men, remember? The Bible says, verse 34, it says, so Jesus had compassion and touched their eyes. And immediately their sight came back. Isn't that wonderful? Now, don't miss those things, because you read that in the Bible and you say, here's these two blind men. They're going, Lord, Lord. They're making it. And the Lord says, great question. He goes, what do you want me to do for you? Hello. Not a very hard question to understand, right? But he wants them to understand. And he looks at them and he says, what do you want me to do for you? And they say, oh, Lord, if we just could see. And then the Bible says, then the Bible says, and Jesus was moved with compassion. Watch. 100% God, yep. 100% man, yep. Isn't that awesome? But one of the things you don't miss about Jesus, don't miss this, is his heart. Is his heart. He looked at these two men who were bound in the world of sin. The world of sin being that the fallen world. The only reason there's blindness is because we live in a fallen world. The only reason there's disease is because we live in a fallen world. And here's the Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord of glory, looking at these two men. His heart goes out because he realizes in his heart, he sees that they can't see. And his heart goes out to them with compassion. He says, receive your sight. And they can see. How awesome that. You say, well, it's a great miracle. No, 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 it's a great miracle, but it's a great heart. The great heart of our Lord. Don't miss that. The leper comes to Jesus one day in Mark 1, verse 41. Then Jesus, moved with compassion, stretched out his hand and touched him. He said, I'm willing. See, this guy knew Jesus could, but he didn't know if he's willing. And Jesus moved with compassion in his heart. Yes, I'm willing. He's just watching. He's seeing this man just bound up with all that mess of leprosy and just what it meant. And he looked at him. He said, my heart goes out to him. If we aren't careful, we will look at God as a force and with no personality and just look at him, a distant force somewhere off, and just go, well, I don't know if he cares. I don't know if he loves. I hope he does. Maybe he does. I'm not sure he does. But then I read my Bible and I go, no, 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 no. He has mercy. He has compassion. Mark chapter 6, verse 34. And Jesus, when he came out, saw a great multitude and was moved with compassion. The Bible says, for them, because they were like sheep not having a shepherd. Jesus looked at them and said, they're lost. They're wandering around. They have no leadership, no guidance. But watch this, his heart, well, he didn't just look and go, well, sorry about those guys over there. He looked and said, you know, my heart goes out to them. I'm the good shepherd. And I see them, they need a shepherd. And his heart went out. And again, we don't have time. If we did, I could read Mark 14, 14, Mark 8, 2, Mark 9, 22, Matthew 9, 36, Matthew 18, 27, Matthew 9, 36, 14, 14, 15, 30. I mean, I got all day. I'm just telling you, there's story after story after story after story after story after story. Did I say story? Story after story after story of Jesus himself being moved with compassion and reaching out to people. Isn't it wonderful? Okay, good news for you. You know why he reached out to you? Compassion and mercy and love. The word compassion that's used here that Jesus uses is splachnizomai. He said gesundheit. Yeah, splachnizomai. And it's a word that means this. It means bowels. Pretty good word. Inner organs, or we would say heart. It means to feel deeply, to yearn, to suffer with. It's a deep feeling. We would say things like this in our term. We would say, well, I feel that in my gut. You ever say that? Well, I'm just, you ever say this? My heart is broken. And you just feel it. I mean, it's just something on the inside, right? It's on the inside of something churning, something just, it's just so deep. It's such a hard, hard emotion. It's you experience something so deep within yourself. Splachnizomai indicates, again, an inner feeling frequently recorded in Jesus' teachings and an attitude about the multitude and about other people. He would be moved with compassion. He would be something so deep and gut-wrenching in his heart, he would be moved to do something. What a great picture that is. This compassion pains the heart, but it also persuades the feet, if I could say it that way. It pains on the inside, but it's not a compassion you look at and just go, oh, it's terrible. Hope everything works out. It's a compassion that causes you to get up and do something. The Good Samaritan was a great picture of that, wasn't it? Same word. He had compassion, right? He saw a need. He saw a guy that other people walked by, and they looked and they said, boy, that's awful. Hope everything works out for you. We're going to pray for you, brother. And they walked on. But the Samaritan did what? He has compassion in his heart. He was moved with compassion. And he looked over and he said, wow, he needs help. And he went over with that compassion in his heart to say, he's hurting. He's bleeding. He may be even dead. I got to go help him. It was a pain in his heart, but persuaded his feet. But I ask you a question. Do you have compassion for anybody? Does your compassion cause you to go and suffer with and come alongside? Jesus is a great example of that. And how awesome it is to see the compassion of Jesus, that he would touch people, he would heal people, he would raise people. I mean, he just do all of that simply because of his compassion and the plan of his Father. And I just tell you, I stopped for a moment as I was going through this going, you know what, Lord, how awesome is it to know that you have compassion? I forget that sometimes, don't you? I honestly forget how compassionate God is. With all the things going on in the world, all the things going on in our life, all the things going on in what we do, we forget what moves God. Compassion. Compassion. Such an important attribute of our Lord and our God to remember. God has, he feels compassion. And that's so important today. And I'll say it again, most of us, again, walk around like God is some force. Let the force be with you, you know. It's like, really? Impersonal. No affection, no emotion. Well, God just does what he does and he has no emotion, nothing. Well, you better read your Bible over again to understand that our God is a God of compassion and love and mercy and grace. I've seen that with Jesus. A lot of times people look at Jesus and go, he's so cold. Just so hard. And that's why you see him in some of these portrayals of in these movies. Used to be years ago, now they do a little different. He's just no emotion, no, never laughs, never smiles. Just always he's almost like he's floating around, you know. That's not him. The one reason I know that is because little kids would come to Jesus and love him. I'm telling you, if Jesus was just a stoic person to stand over in the corner, the kids would go, ooh, no thanks. Jesus is picking him up. He's just there with the people loved him. Some of them hated him. But he was loved because, again, his compassion. He would touch people no one would touch. He would talk to people no one would talk to. He would heal people no one. He would eat with people no one wanted to eat with. And they ridiculed him, and eventually they put him on a cross for it, for his compassion. Let me read just a couple of these verses to you. Psalm 103, verse 8. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in mercy. He will not always strive with us, nor will he keep his anger forever. For he has not dealt with us according to our sins, nor punished us according to our iniquities. For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is his mercy toward those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. As a father pities his children, so the Lord pities those who fear him. And he knows our frame. He remembers that we are dust. How's that? You know, hey, listen, God knows who you are. God knows where you've been. Yet he is compassionate and merciful. I mean, if anybody he ought to turn his back on, it would have been the Israelites, right? Doing all these great miracles for them, leading them all through. Got manna here. You got rock here. He's feeding them with. He's doing all these kind of things. Red Sea opening up. All of them gone. And all of a sudden, they're down there, and just in not a short period of time, worshiping a golden calf. But he's compassionate. He's loving. He's patient. By the way, don't presume on the patience of God. Don't just look at God and go, well, he'll always be there. No. He's a loving God. But again, he's a God of wrath. He's a God of justice. He's a God of righteousness. But one thing you don't want to forget about him is he is a God of mercy. Joel chapter 2, verse 13 says this. So rend your heart and not your garments. Return to the Lord your God, for it says, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and great kindness. He relents from doing harm. Lamentations 3, verse 22. Though the Lord's mercies are not, we are not, through the Lord's mercies, we are not consumed, because his compassions fail not. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. Now I love James chapter 5, verse 11. You have heard of the perseverance of Job and seen the end intended by the Lord, that the Lord is very compassionate and merciful. I love the great picture of the compassion of our Lord. This sets him apart from all the other false gods of the world. You look it up, just do your little Google search, as we say in the office, Google it. You can Google it. Google it. You're not going to find any false gods that are compassionate, have compassion. They're just not. By the way, sinful man making a false god is not going to be a compassionate false god. Because man by nature is not compassionate. Man by nature is a little two-year-old in the nursery. Got his own little toy. He looks somebody else, picks up a toy, and he goes, I want that one too. And he goes over and gets it. Now you got to fight, right? It happens all the time. Little sin nature coming out. That's exactly what happens. In the world we live today, it's amazing to me how a lost and dying world can turn away from a loving and compassionate God that we have. But they do. I'm so thankful for his compassion. Many people say this, they've said this to me, and I'm sure they said it to you as well. So, Ron, I've done so many bad things. God can't care about me. Ron, if you only knew my past, if you only knew what I did, if you only knew where I've been, you'd understand I can't come to God because I'm so ashamed. And I know God remembers, and I know God knows because I remember and I know, and there's no way I just can't come to him. You ever heard that?
Yeah.
I won't ask you if you ever said that, but you may have. Did you know, again, because God is who he is, that's the great picture of compassion. God knows your frame. He knows that you're but dust. You're created from dust. You understand it, right? We're just our flesh. He knows we're flesh. He made us. He knows us. Yet he still chooses to love us. Let me give you another verse. Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 30. The word here is this. It's a word for, it's El Rahum is a word in Hebrew. And it's a word that means compassionate God. There's a name for God that, again, it just means that. He's compassionate. Compassionate and merciful God. El Rahum is the word. And so he says this. He says, when you are in distress and all these things come to you in the latter days, when you turn to the Lord your God and obey his voice, for the Lord your God is a merciful God. There's the word. Merciful God. And El Rahum is the word. He's the God of mercy and compassion. He will not forsake you nor destroy you nor forget the covenant of your fathers, which he swore to them. God's even got a name, El Rahum, meaning compassion. That's his name. Isn't that awesome?
Yeah.
So let's rewind. Right? I've done so many things. I'm so bad. I can't get over my past. I can't stop. God knows that. And yet he's still there. He knows where you've been, yet he's still there. He knows what you've done, yet he's still there. It's a great picture, isn't it, the prodigal son? The prodigal son turns his back on his father, turns his back on his family, turns his back on everything, goes and squanders everything in the world, yet the father every day would go to the edge of the road looking for his boy. The father was still there. He never left. The son left. The son moved. The son went down the road. The son got involved in all the mess, but the father was still there. And what did he do when he came home? He didn't look at him and go, "I can't, what is wrong with you?" Which is what we might say. It's almost like you didn't even listen to him, right? The guy comes back, he looks at him and says, "Oh, Father, I've sinned against God. I've sinned against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Just make me a servant." And it's almost like the father's not listening. He turns away. He's hugging his dirty old boy. He looks at him and he says, "Go get him a robe. Go get him some sandals. Go get him my ring. My boy's returned. We're going to celebrate. Kill the fatted calf, by the way." What is he saying? He said, compassion. Yeah, but he did all these things. Compassion. Yeah, but he did all love, mercy, forgiveness, and compassion. That's the great. I love it when Jesus says, "I've had compassion on these people. I have compassion." It's a great picture, and we could take more time to look at a lot of different verses talking about compassion. Aren't you thankful today for God's compassion?
Amen.
Are you?
Amen.
Let me give you just a bigger picture of that. John 3:16. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only," what? "Begotten Son, whosoever believes in him would not perish but have everlasting life." For God so loved. Watch this. Compassion. Was that compassion? Oh. Why was that compassion? Because he saw our need. The old song, Brother Jamie, "He looked beyond my fault and saw my need." My need was to be saved. My need was to be forgiven. My need was to get right with God. And he looked beyond my fault and saw my need. He died for my fault and he saw my need. You know why he died? Watch. Compassion. His love. "For God so loved you that he gave for you." He provided love for you in the Jesus on the cross. That's why every once in a while somebody says, "Well, God's a God of this and he's a God of that." I'll tell you what he's a God of. He's a God of the cross. You look at the cross. You want to see Jesus? You want to see what God's like? Jesus will tell them disciples, he'd say, "You've seen me, you've seen the Father." You want to see what God looks like? Go to the cross. Go to the tomb. Go to the resurrection. And you're going to find out that great God who loved you so much died for you, died for me, so we could be forgiven. That is compassion.
Amen.
And anybody turns their back on that, again, stand before God one day. It's almost like God, again, the great picture, God's going to say, he's going to look at you, "Hey, I need to get into heaven. I gave my son for you and you rejected my son. I gave everything for you. You turned away. My love, you turned away." How do you turn away from the love of God? Again, what a great picture for us to understand the great gospel of Jesus Christ. 2 Corinthians 8:9, Paul says, "For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that you through his poverty might become rich." He stepped out of heaven, all of his glory, came to this earth, died for you and for me, so that we could be rich before God. That is compassion. That is love. God, again, sees us for who we are and sacrificed his son. What a great picture that is. To appease the wrath of God, Jesus died for our sins. Love it. Compassion. Not only to have compassion for our ultimate salvation, but I love it just in a moment. He has compassion for the small things as well. Every once in a while we look at God and we go, "Okay, God, I know you're up in heaven. I know you're pretty busy dealing with the crisis of all this, you know. But I got this little problem over here, and I'd like to just come to you and talk to you, but I know you're too busy for me." The Bible says this, "Whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God." Did you know that one little bird doesn't fall to the ground unless God sees it? And we're much more valuable than that, he says. So I understand. Jesus looks and he goes, These people have been with me for 3 days. What's he been doing for 3 days? Healing and teaching, healing and teaching, healing and teaching. Now, we've been out there. I'm telling you, if you get to go with us, you'll get to see some of these areas to Israel. We're trying to look, Lord willing, get to try to go in March. But what the thing about it is this, you go out there, and it's summertime, it's hot. These people hadn't eaten in 3 days. Jesus says, if they try to go home in this kind of mess, they're going to faint. The word faint means they're going to fall out. And Jesus, well, that's just a little thing. I have compassion for them. I don't want them to be hungry. I don't want them to faint. Again, I love this because it shows me a little bit of insight to know that God loves and cares for the little things in my life. Not just the big things, but the small things, the little things. I can't find this. Lord, will you help me find that? And then God moves. You see, whoa, look what God did, a little thing. That's no big deal. Yeah, it's a big deal to God because it's a big deal to us. Compassion. I love to see the compassion of God. Matthew 15:11, the Gentiles saw it as well, didn't they? Because the Bible says this in Matthew 15:31, that they glorified the God of Israel. God did great and wonderful things. Now, let me just give you a couple things real quick. I know that I wanted to hit that pretty hard because I think that's the most important thing I wanted you to see out of this text this morning. But notice the confusion of the disciples real quick, verse 4. And you look at that and you go, guys, it was just a few months before that. He just fed 20,000 people. Certainly didn't forget. How in the world can you say that? And his disciples answered and said, how can one satisfy these people with bread here in the wilderness? In other words, no bread in the wilderness. It's no bread. What are you going to do? How are you going to take care of it? A commitment. Either disciples forgot, which I don't think they did. I think they still understood. But I do think this, that I think, just like we said a moment ago, I think a lot of times we forget, don't we? God will do something great in your life. You ever do this? You're praying, oh, God, help me. Oh, God, heal me. Oh, God, do this. God, do this. And all of a sudden, God does it, and you go, wow, praise the Lord. Next. And I'm going on to my next thing in life, and I forget what he just did. How he miraculously just did what I asked him to do. We forget that, don't we? And it don't take long, does it? I mean, 9/11 was a great illustration of that years ago. 9/11 hit, churches were packed. You could not find a place to sit. But give it a few months, everybody's back in the routine of life. So that may have happened to them. I don't think they forgot, but I think they may have just been so focused on this. I think one of the things, too, is this. They could have remembered but recognized that their own resources, they didn't have any availability. As we said before, there's nothing open. We say things like this, and I look at this and I go, with the bread of life standing right before them, how could they not think that? But then I think about this, too. Have you ever prayed this way? But then we talk about this a lot. You ever prayed this way? Somebody come to you and say, man, I'm having allergy problems. I'm having a headache. Can you pray for me? And we go, absolutely. Absolutely. God, in the name of Jesus, we want you to touch this person and just take that away. And we pray for those things like Jesus is standing right there. Right? Yeah. Absolutely. It'll be somebody come to you and say, would you pray for my? Yeah, I'll do that. But watch this. Then somebody comes to you and says, man, I got stage 4 cancer. Can you pray for me? And we go, ooh, well, we can pray. And we do. But there's something about the impossible, we think, that God does more of the practical things than we think he does the impossible things. And maybe we don't pray with faith in the impossible as much as we might just pray for something we know that can be taken care of with an aspirin. I think these disciples were confused. I think they were so involved with everything around them that they missed the real picture of who was standing right there. The great God, the Creator, who created everything, is standing right there before them. And can't you imagine? I read one thing. Can't you imagine somebody going, you got your 12 disciples there, and they're there, and somebody stands up and says, where are we going to feed? How are we going to feed these people? And can't you imagine somebody, one of the disciples in the background going, ooh, shouldn't ask him that. Remember what happened a few months ago? I'm glad you asked him. I see that. I happened in seminary one time. I won't tell you the story. Guy asked a question, and we're all like, ooh, man, don't ask him that. That's not the good. And it was ugly. I mean, but not here. Jesus just looks and goes, yeah, okay. You don't understand, right? You don't understand. You remember what happened before? Okay, I'm still here, still God. And I want to tell you something. As we journey in our walk with Jesus, we should never forget that he's God. He's still God. He's God over the small things. He's God over the big things. He created it all. So a great picture there that we see. Maybe these guys, and just are still trying to understand how Jesus could even think about doing a miracle for a Gentile. Maybe that's what it is. I love what it says in verse 4. And his disciples answered him, said, watch this. Now, I have the emphasis here, but how can one satisfy these people with bread? Could have been the way they said it. How can we satisfy these people? Nothing here. Watch that. Again, be careful judging, because that's the way they were brought up. That's the way they were taught. Again, over and over again, the Samaritan woman, remember that? She would say, how are you, a Jew, asking me for a drink of water? You don't have anything to do with us, remember? So again, that may be their situation there. It's a confusion to the disciples. We get confused. But then also, then thirdly, there's a creation of the Lord. And I won't take a lot of time here. Again, you just understand this. He created it all, right? He said, how many fish you got? How many pieces of bread you got? Or loaves of bread? He goes, 7. And a few fish, all right? Here's what we're going to do. And just stop for a moment and think with me about the creation part of this. Again, he's who? He's God, right? Right? Amen? He's God. He created all anyway. And so here's a great picture. He's creating. But I wonder what that must have looked like. You got some bread, and you got a few fish, little sardines. And I don't know if he put them in a basket, and he prayed to the Father, and he just reached in, and he put it out, and he reached in and put it out. But I got to think about it, too. If you look at it, he created bread that was never in the field. It just showed up out of nowhere. I mean, just bread, more bread. Bread, more bread. I mean, you're feeding thousands of people. He created fish, watch this, that were never alive and they never died, but they were dead when they showed up, ready to eat. How's that? I just would like to see that, a picture of that, wouldn't you? And we get to heaven, it's going to be wonderful because we see all this. But I mean, the fact that he's just pulling out, and I don't know about you, but I'm a disciple. I'm going, here we go again. Wow. It's amazing, just the fact that he's creating something out of nothing. But again, why should that surprise us? Because he did the very thing with the world, doesn't he? Genesis 1:1, and I won't take time to read that. But I will read this, John 1, verse 3. All things were made through him, talking about Jesus, and without him nothing was made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men, and the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. There was nothing made in this world that was not made through Christ. Nothing. So all of a sudden now he's creating, right? They're confused. He showed compassion. They're confused, trying to figure it out, and he's just creating. And then fourthly is the contentment of the people. Look at verse 8. So they ate and were filled, and they took up 7 large baskets of leftover fragments. Again, won't take a long time with this, other than the fact that they were satisfied completely. Can I tell you something, what Jesus does? He satisfies completely. He satisfies completely. That's why we look, if you're a Christian, you look and you go, man, how do people live without Jesus? They'll go through a funeral. They'll go through something major, tragic in their life, and they're not saved. They don't know Christ. And as a believer, we step back and we look and with your heart, there's compassion for them, because we look at them and go, how do you deal with that without Christ? Why? Because Christ satisfies, even in the most difficult days of life. Even the best of days and the worst of days, Jesus satisfies. He's enough. The Bible tells us that in Jesus we are complete. Complete. Then the conclusion, let's ask this question, we're done. What did the Gentiles learn on their journey? What did they learn? They learned, number one, that Jesus is God. Disciples, what did you learn? That Jesus is God. Over and over and over again, Jesus would say this, things like, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So the truth is, they saw him as man, they saw him as the man God, they saw him as Almighty God. That was the journey, as they're walking around, they're seeing, they're talking, they're listening to him teach over and over and over again, showing that he and he alone is God. Another thing they found out about Jesus is he's a healer. He is God and he heals. Matthew 15:31, the Bible tells us that he healed the mute, caused them to speak, the blind to see, the maimed. When you see that word maimed, it means disabled, deformed, made them whole, the lame walk. And they're seeing Jesus do things that no one has ever done. They're seeing him touch people and do things. They're seeing God's power through him. They're seeing Jesus as God. They're seeing the power of God go through him and work through the people. Then thirdly, there's understanding of that this worship side of it. They're starting to see how Jesus is to be worshiped. Not just looked at and said, hey, he's a great healer. Hey, he's a great Messiah. He's this and that. But he's to be worshiped. So much so that the Gentiles looked in Matthew 15:31 and said, the Bible says, they worship the God of Israel. They worship the Jews' God because of Jesus. And then fourthly, they understood that Jesus provided. He was the provision, that he supplied all their need, the good, the bad, the indifferent. All the things they needed in life, he provided for them. And then lastly, they understood that Jesus had compassion. They understood that he loved them, that he loved people, and that what they learned in their life growing up was not the true picture of who God was. That they learned, again, as they watched him and they saw him, they stepped back and they admired and just watched to see what he did and how he did it, that he loved and he had compassion. How awesome is that? Now, here's my question. In your journey, in your walk with Jesus, do you know he's God? Do you understand that he is the provider? He provides everything you need. He is worthy to be worshiped. And he loves, a compassionate love that he has. You may be here this morning and say, you know what? Man, Ron, you just don't know my life. I don't, but guess who does? God does. And the Bible says that, again, though we were, again, separated from him, away from him, Jesus died for us. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Do you know Christ? Maybe in your heart, maybe in your mind, maybe in your life, in your gut feeling today, you look and you go, you know what? I would like to know this Jesus. I would like to have Christ. I need my sins forgiven. Ron, I know I'm a sinner. I know I've separated from my sin separates from me from God. I know that. But one thing, Ron, I didn't really understand was how much God loves me. Well, listen, friend, God loves you with an everlasting love. He loves you so much that he died on a cross for you. And in your heart today, you look and say, you know what? I want this Jesus. I want to be saved. You can call on his name and give your life to him today. That's why he does what he does, the compassion of God. It's the goodness of God that calls us and leads us to repentance. Because I see how awesome he is, and I see how powerful he is, and I see how loving he is, and merciful and graceful he is. And I look and I go, I want that. And it causes me in my heart to go, I turn from my sin, and I turn to you by faith. Maybe that's where you're at today. Maybe you're a Christian. You say, you know what, man, I've just been living the life, going through the motions. I need to get back into, again, our song this morning. I believe it. Now I need to live it out. As I walk with Jesus, I need to tell everyone that he's God, that he loves them, that he died for them, and we need to worship him in all his glory. Would you bow with me? Simple invitation today. Do you know Christ? If in your heart today you look and say, I'd like to know Jesus. I'd like to have him forgive me of my sins. I'd like to call upon his name. Friend, you can call upon his name today. And if in your heart you say, you know what, I want Christ, he'll save you today. He'll change your life. See, he's a great God. He's a compassionate God. He's a patient God. He's a loving God. Would you turn to him today? In just a moment, we're going to stand. Brother Jamie's going to lead us, and we're going to sing a few, but if you're here this morning, you say, you know what, I want to give my life to Christ. I'm going to ask you to come, take me by the hand, say, Pastor, today's the day. I'm trusting Christ as my Savior. We'll rejoice with you, give you some material to help you on your journey. But if you need Jesus today and that God is calling you and reaching out in your heart and you say, yes, I need to come to Christ, you come. Trust him today. If you're a Christian today, maybe God's just doing right where your heart is. You say, you know what, let's get serious about this thing. Let's get focused. Let's tell the world. No matter who they are, no matter where they are, no matter what they do, let's tell the world that I love them. Maybe you need to join this church where God's called you to be. We'd love to have you be a part of our church family. But whatever your need this morning, as we stand here in a moment, you come. I lead us in prayer. Father, thank you for the privilege of opening your word and giving us a little glimpse of what it was like to walk with you. Lord, my heart is that I'm very weak in trying to explain the scriptures. But Lord, I thank you for giving us a glimpse of what it must have been like to walk with you during the times of with the Jews and, Father, with the Gentiles alike. Bless today, Father, your word, and I pray your Holy Spirit would touch the hearts of those who need to come to you by faith, and Father, those of us, again, who just need to be challenged to step up and say, you know what, let's get serious about this call and go forward telling people what we believe, because you are the truth, the way, and the life. We thank you as you bless this service for your glory in Jesus' name.